Hey guys, it's John with NRSNG.com, and today we're going to talk about preload versus afterload. What are these two numbers? Why do they matter? And we'll just do a really quick video about what these are, what they mean. If you hang on till the end of the video, I'm going to give you a little chart that's going to help you kind of make sense in your mind about what exactly is going on, okay? So to start, here's our heart, okay? We have our atria on top, ventricles on bottom, here's our mitral valve, and here's our aortic valve, and this is going to be the aorta pumping blood out to the body. So primarily to talk about preload and afterload, we're going to kind of talk about the left side of the heart. Left atria, left ventricle, aorta, and mitral valve, okay? So before we do that, we need to understand where preload and afterload come into the game. Okay, so first of all, we have what is stroke volume. Stroke volume is the volume of blood pumped out of the heart with each beat. And normally, stroke volume is going to be 60 to about 120 mils per beat. Okay, so that is our parameter that we're kind of looking at. How much blood is going out of the heart with each beat? Okay, and there's three things that affect stroke volume. First is going to be contractility. And contractility is really the squeeze of these ventricles. How hard are these ventricles squeezing to push blood out? And we can talk later about things that will affect that. So it's really the squeeze of these ventricles. Okay. The other two things that are going to affect how much volume is going out of the blood out of the heart with each beat is going to be preload. And I'm sure you guessed it, afterload. Okay. So preload and afterload are one of the three parameters that directly affect stroke volume. Okay, so we'll go back over here to our heart. So over here on our heart, we have our atria, ventricles, and our aorta. Okay, so preload, when we talk about preload, what we're talking about is we're really kind of talking about a volume. Okay? So preload comes down to how much volume is in the ventricles at the end of diastole, okay? So the number that we're really kind of looking at here is end diastolic volume, okay? And we know that diastole is when the atria are contracting, okay? So during diastole, atria are going to contract, and what's going to happen with that is it's going to push blood down into our ventricles, okay? So that is preload. It's a volume of blood at the end of diastole, okay? And so the number that we're looking at is end diastolic volume, all right? So mitral valve is going to open. Blood is going to go from atria to ventricles. It's going to fill the ventricle, and that is our end diastolic volume. That's the preload, okay? Afterload, on the other hand, is a pressure. Okay? So once diastole is completed, the mitral valve is going to close. And the next thing that needs to happen is the aortic valve needs to open. But in order for that aortic valve to open, it has to overcome a very specific pressure. It has to overcome the pressure of the volume in the system keeping the aortic valve closed, okay? So there's always blood throughout our entire bloodstream, right? And that blood creates a pressure, you know, that's our blood pressure, that's our systolic and then our diastolic pressure, of course. So that blood that's sitting in the system is going to exert a pressure, okay? So we have a pressure coming back on here. So our afterload is the pressure required to open the aortic valve, okay? And the two numbers that we're going to look at for that are systemic vascular resistance and pulmonary vascular resistance, okay? So with systemic vascular resistance, what we're looking at is the resistance, the pressure of the systemic circulation that it's pushing back against this aortic valve. So in order for blood to get out of the ventricles, it has to open this aortic valve. But in order for that to happen, the pressure in your left ventricle has to be greater than the pressure distal to the aortic valve. So that is your systemic vascular resistance. Pulmonary vascular resistance is referring to the pressure required over here in the right ventricle to open the pulmonic valve, okay? So that's really it. That's preload versus afterload. Preload equals pressure. Afterload, I'm sorry, I just messed that up. Preload equals volume. Afterload equals pressure. All right, preload is the volume. In diastolic volume, the volume in the ventricles at the end of diastole. Afterload is the pressure required to open these valves and get the blood out of the ventricles. Okay, so that's the really short video for this. We're going to get into more things that we can do to directly affect these numbers or preload or afterload in our contractility and how we can affect those. If a patient has a low systemic vascular resistance, what are we going to do to bring that up? If a patient has a low preload or a low end diastolic volume, how are we going to increase that or how can we decrease it? So we'll talk about different disorders that might cause these numbers to be altered and what we can do to fix that. But in the meantime, if you head over to nrsng.com/hemodynamics, you can get a free download, a little chart that has all of this graphed out, including heart rate, cardiac output, cardiac index, and different numbers that we can, and how we can manipulate high or low values. So that's nrsng.com/hemodynamics. All right, so I really appreciate you checking out this video. I hope that helps make sense. Preload volume, afterload pressure, and kind of what those numbers mean. That's really all you have to remember basically for NCLEX, for nursing exams, what these are, and then we'll get more into what normal values are and how to adjust those later on. All right, so I hope you have a great day. Visit nrsng.com/hemodynamics and you can get that free chart. Thank you.